Wild Wild West, they call it, you know what I'm saying? Home of Traxman, ghetto tech, ghetto DJ crew. Look at him, you know. Folks just don't give a fuck. You know? Shit's real.
He came along, and I ain't gonna even front. I ain't gonna even front on camera because I know Clint, he'll call my bluff, he'll talk shit about it. I didn't like the track. I hated the track. You know what I'm saying? I hated the track with all my might. I'm like, what the fuck is this bullshit, man? But, man, that track just, like, it took a world of its own. This is, I call this one of the births of footwork tracks. That's when it started.
The sound of footwork will be amazing. The sound, the true sound of it is about telling the story with the sample, but the sound, if it's produced right, it has a funky groove to it, and it can catch you. It has soul in it. From my perspective of what I do, it has soul music in it to where it's a first time hearing it play the right track. It's like something that's totally new.
And it changed from just like dance booty music to people actually getting together with dance crew. That's when it turned to like juking and footwork. And then when you footworking, of course, is the actual act of being out there and engaging in the dance flow battle or just footworking, period. Just to display your skill.
Footwork track is more, I feel it has more soul to it. I sample stuff that I grew up playing or listening to with my mom when she was DJing. And I sample that stuff and make it my way.
It's more of a format that we created. And now we kind of like intertwine the juke, like as far as like the party element with the footwork. So you may have a Beyonce sample, you know, something for the ladies, which is like a juke connotation, with a hard beat, which is for the footworkers.
Like you hit the juke shit, you know, juke would just start, but then you hit another little thing with people want to get no bros that had no moves, like, you know, I can dance, you know, I can, you know, do my footwork, you know what I'm saying, in a circle, you know, because people were fascinated by that. But then again, you hit the girls when the parts come, though, you got the girls hitting the floor.
Footwork has become a long way. I remember it was times where we'd be DJing, well, I'd be DJing, and the promoter would come up to me like, man, why you playing all them footwork tracks? Why you playing all you playing too many footwork tracks? Play the juke tracks. Because at the time, all the females would be just standing around and all the guys in the corners battling. So it kind of offset the party.
So we making like hybrids. Like we've been doing it for a while, but like just to keep it all is what it is. It's juke and footwork. It is a slash, but at the end of the day, it's all juke. You know, it's all juke music and it's the juke culture.
But it was already footwork tracks. You know what I'm saying? I can't understand. Like it's footworking and the older is house stuff. It's footworking and the percolator stuff, and it's footworking in the early ghetto house stuff. You know, but so I guess it just kind of like all mushed together and they had like a song now. But it's off those like forefathers of music, you know what I'm saying? And that's what I'm trying to teach, you know what I'm saying? But these were the tracks that really, you know what I'm saying, that really like started it. And no, I can't leave out Rashad. Definitely can't leave out Rashad. They did a track called Child Abuse. And Spinn, he did a track called Motherfucker. And those were the tracks, you know what I'm saying, that like birthing footwork tracks.
Welcome to the warehouse. Enjoy our music.
In house music period, the tone was set at 140, 30. We sped it up a little bit to 150. And the dancers wanted us to speed up more. So it's all set at 160 though. But at any very moment given time, we can slow it back down to 150, 140, etc. They still gonna shoot, but they ain't gonna be as fast as if it was a good 160 motherfucker. Yeah. But now you might be able to see the moves needed. You
know, what's the highest BPM you've ever fucked with?
As far as DJing?
Yeah.
I have to say 168. Mm. And that was a West Side party with Traxman. Back in the day, 7, 6, 8 years ago, I should say, the West Side was known for playing their music 45. They called it, the shit was fast. So like, if percolating, it's time for the percolator. You get out there, they're playing that shit, like, it's time for the percolator. It's time for the percolator. Sit in my voice and shit. So we met the West Side halfway since they come out south. And we did 160, and it's been working ever since. And,
so who else were you feeling back then as far as producing?
DJ Dion. The number one, man, that's like my fucking idol. DJ fucking Dion and DJ Milton. The shit was unbelievable back in the day. The music I used to hear off the mixtapes. Like I said, I started DJing in sixth grade. That shit, their tapes were out when I was in like fifth grade. I used to think they may have the shit that was on the tape, you know, until I did my investigation and started DJing and whatnot. But yeah, shout out to DJ Dion. Motherfucking DJ Milton and Traxman too. Yeah, they're my idols. Besides Paul Johnson, he's also definitely a big influence into what I do today.
Definitely, you know, because they, you know, and Clint and RP, they was like the forefront kind of to like everybody as far as making tracks.
When you hit Spinn with Shine, it was like, what the fuck is this shit right here?
You know, you could tell a ghetto tech track. I mean, even if it's like, it don't matter who it is, you could tell a tech track. It just stand out.
Tech life, pretty much, that's a collective. Of the minds and the brains and the music behind the movement that we doing is tech life. Tracks, footworking, it's the lifestyle of juking and footworking, but our twist on it. We technicians of the craft that we do, you know, we get on them beat machines and them computers and we get technical with it. But ghetto.
Who is the ghetto technician?
Me, Shy. Manny, Earl, Traxman, Gantman,
General Juke, aka DJ Gantman, you know what I'm saying? Tech Life.
DJ Remy, DJ Pills, DJ Trey, Big Phil, AG, Frost, man, there's a lot of us. Boylan.
I think I remember the time I was officially, I mean, Rashad told me I was ghetto tech a long time ago, but I think I was officially in when we were in. We were riding around in this thing, I got picked up by Spinn and Rashad, and they just turned around and said, you're ghetto tech.
Man, Curtis, Rolo, Sonic, and we kind of deep. And I might have forgot somebody else. I think that's it, I think. After we was like in a couple different crews, you know, we was with a Beatdown crew. Me and Rashad came together, we was out in Detroit. We was like, man, let's just do our own crew. Why not?
I met Spinn when I was like in eighth grade. I really got cool with him like high school, freshman year. We were in the same homeroom.
We always rep other people's crew. Let's do our own crew. And we was kicking it with DJ Godfather from Detroit. And, you know, that's the home of ghetto tech. You know what I'm saying? So we was just like, man, why don't y'all just kind of, you know, why don't y'all go back ghetto technician? So thought about it. Like, man, yeah, that's kind of dope. Like, yeah, ghetto tech, man.
They are saving the game. Ghetto techs have saved the game. Ain't nobody else out here, man. It wouldn't be no footwork without it. Cause I definitely, a lot of my niggas wouldn't even be dancing out here. We had to dance all these other niggas' music.
One of the greatest DJs here, Sox. You know what I'm saying? Walk with me, 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 walk with me. I'll see you after the function. Walk with me, 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 walk with me.
Baby police, act like no life, Taliban, TOC, red legend.
Who are the Red Legends?
Red Legends,
boy. Red Legends are based on everyone who's been a part of the last and the dying breed of the Chicago movement. We just consist of a group that's kind of underground, but now it's starting to come to the light, and we just willing to all grind until it's the real footwork scene is worldwide, until it's seen. But I'm gonna go from old to new. I'm just gonna demonstrate certain stuff that's how it used to be done old, and then how it's done now. So first step, I'm gonna show you the skates. This is how the old skates used to be. Now people mic with the skates now. You know what I'm saying? So we changed that, and then that. The new era. Now it used to be the basic crossovers. Now people. You know what I'm saying? They changed that, we go. No, it's kind of like a van. So I used to be like, oh, run the millions. That's these. Now it used to be the old mics. Now people. They switched all up. Like everything really got kind of similar to change. Used to be, you know, so many old moves. Now people, you know, so many ways. Like everything evolved for good, but not always good. As far as the members, it's me, Lightbulb Manny, Clint, Spinn, Rashad, Eli, Darion.
I've been dancing since I was like 11.
Can I hold you?
I'll be 30.
Steve-O, Hot.
My name Hot. I dance with Red Legends.
It's Hot.
Yeah, Q.
I've been footworking since I'm like 9.
We got more that's up and coming. They gotta work together.
No, it's a team. We stay as a team. You know what I'm saying? We all from different crews, but Red Legends, we still go with that one umbrella. And I'm a big fan of the DJs, and the DJs a big fan of the footwork. And we've been supporting each other since day one, you know. And, you know, you can't do one without the other.
It's like a three-way tie right now, as far as tracks. To me, in my eye, it's like a three-way tie. And it's between Manny, Spinn, and Rashad. You know, they are more, way more consistent when it comes to sitting in the studio and grinding than anybody else.
Actually, it's a four-way, so I have to put Traxman with Spinn, Rashad, and Manny. Because all of them, they just sit and make tracks all day.
This nigga right here is one of my idols.
This is my little bro right here. You know what I'm saying? I wish I had that record. He's doing my own shit. I started in 81. Thanks to my mother, because she played all the Harold Melvin with the Blue Notes, the OJ, Teddy Pendergrass, Delphonics, you know, a lot of good soul music. My mama gave me money to go back and forth to school. Damn all that. I'm finna take the bus to Import Records downtown on Plymouth or Loop Records and buy me some records. I'm buying Get the Hope. I heard Farley play Get the Hope. I gotta have it.
Then it'll be me. Then RP Boo, because RP, he makes tracks whenever he feel like it.
Sounds. That's what the speakers are for.
RP Boo. The infamous. He's just infamous, like, of ways he did his tracks. And
RP, OG. Legend.
Frost, you not going that hard. And I ain't putting you on the spot. Go hard, my nigga.
I was introduced to RP Boo in 97. No dark skin nigga. Man, what
up, yo? What's up, yo? What's going on, man?
RP.
This nigga is cool as hell, but he was weird. I'm like, man, these tracks is weird, bro. But the dances was going so crazy to him.
The RP boy. You know what I'm saying?
My name to the world and the music scene will be Arpebu, the one and only. Well, what do? My specialty is I like to play music, make music, and like to see people dance and have a good time. That's just the beginning. The whole length of time I have been doing it all is actually 22 years.
One of my first tracks or tracks?
No, one of yours.
One of mine would be like seventh grade at Markham Roller Rink. It was a song called Ball 'Em Up. And Ball 'Em Up means like fuck 'em up, like in a circle. And the first time I played it, everybody, it was a good response. And from that moment on, I said, yeah, I could do this shit.
And you gotta understand, they was dancers before they was DJs. So you gotta understand, they know the feeling.
Dance, but you really gotta hit, like, get off your feet. Yeah, I ain't gonna do it. I'm gonna be tired.
Spinn had straight combos, though. Mm-hmm. He had nothing but combos. Good footwork, but Rashad.
I was dancing when I was like 7 or 8. Freshman in high school, we got serious, started getting into dance groups. Okay, can I get some hot sauce on that for you? Thank you.
He was like the entertaining type dancer. He had the combos and the moves. Like, Rashad is, that's what dancing was different then, though. It was like, you know what I'm saying? It wasn't as neat then. Like, it was a lot of moves Rashad used to pull out his ass.
You know what you want to feel, you know what I'm saying, as a dancer. And you can relate to
RPBU as well, right?
RPBU, yeah, RPBU is a dancer.
RP.
Yes, I do dance as well, but that came kind of later to be seen to the world, but I was sneaking it in off and on, so I picked up the jack of both trades, dancing and spinning the music.
Ghetto
But is there anyone sort of younger coming up that you think's got potential, maybe?
I would have to say Manny, Earl, are they like the head of the next generation to me.
I started hearing about Manny. I'm like, damn, who the fuck is Manny? This little dude's fucking wrong.
Where you at, Teklife?
I was footworking first, then I started producing, and after that, I learned how to make DJ, you know.
But when I met him, I'm like, oh, this dude's fucking bananas. Then I met Earl.
I'm producing him first, actually. Actually, dancing, then producing.
You know, all this like 07, 08-ish, you know what I'm saying? These kids, you know what I'm saying? I'm like, damn. Now I really know I got to step my game up now, because now you got these kids doing tracks, sounding like Rashad, but kind of in a whole nother way, him and Spinn, you know, what the fuck?
What made me want to start DJing in 2008 when I met Spinn and Rashad at Battlegrounds, and I heard they tracks and was like amazed, like it was a whole different, like, level of tracks, and I saw how the dance were responding to it. That's when I figured out that I wanted to be like a full-time, doing this full-time, and I stopped dancing and everything, so, you know, to become a DJ. Do this. I found the passion for it. And just work hard at it.
Manny, I met shit when he was like 8, and around the same time, yeah. Manny was like dancing like 8 when I was dancing. So I known these damn near half of my life, all my life, damn near.
But he used to be at my house every day. At 11 o'clock in the morning, just to show me how dedicated he was. Look at the man he is now.
I kept going. I kept at it, you know. I kept putting my tracks out there. when I felt that they was good, I put them out there. Just keep doing your thing.
Old day Manny, because he's a type of producer that he dances and he know how to spin and he makes tracks good because I can play some hit. I can play
because that nigga got passion.
That nigga got some shit.
Oh, it's bad. This dude right here. He get a little future.
I think it helps being a dancer with, like, first.
It helps.
Especially if you was good at dancing. If you got any type of musical rhythm, it's gonna convey over to your producer.
Would you describe it as like dancing in your head, going from your feet to your head?
I do that when I make tracks. I sit there and stop and do some of my feet.
Don't watch that TV. It's Tim and Barry. I came in high king. Just jam taking over. Don't watch that TV. Just jam taking over. Don't watch that TV.
Been dancing for since around 94. 94?
When I was 12? 12. Ooh, I started dancing at about freshman year of high school, so I was about 14 to 15.
Footworkers. I used to go to the rink. There's a little like where everybody partying around there. And they used to get all the girls, all the ladies.
I started meeting a lot of different people all around. I done been from Cavaliers on back to Jackson Park, all through the city dancing. Man, you know, they made the name of my high school. You know, that's where it really started for me in high school.
I just come to sit on the sideline like everybody else. Watch moves, go to the career practice amongst myself. I was whack. Yeah, I was whack.
We got taught out off of all slow tracks, like just perform the craft, you know, perfect, master it. And, you had a lot of basics that you was showing, you know. We was taught if you didn't know basics, you didn't know what you was doing.
Now they call them basics, I just call it dancing.
The boy got basics.
Whatever they have taught you, it's good to learn the basics, but if you learn the basics, you break out of it.
Like, basics is like dribbling the ball, the 1-2. You gotta know how the basics dribble the ball from hand to hand. Like, basics would be like some walking. I gotta walk through this move to get to another one for a basic. Like, you know what I'm saying? Just some regular earth or some shit.
Footworking has rules, too. They tell you to do all your moves from left to right. You have to, they say, you have to learn your basics and combinations. But on actuality, once you learn that, downwards. What are you doing, putting together, make a button? No, you take everything and break it apart. What if I do a bunch of basics, different ways, spinning, whatever, it's a completely different move now. What if I just took this move off, I saw it on commercial, took that move, and that's footwork now. Soul train, whatever, it all comes back to footwork. So that's what I like about it, because there's no limits, dude. You break the rules. See, that's why people don't get too good at anything, because they're so stuck in the rules. You got to get outside of your box, your shell.
It's called a label. Anything is labeled, you just stuck.
The first footwork move that anybody ever taught me was the earth. When you learn how to earth, it's just a right, left, and then once you learn the right, left, you got to learn to walk over, back to the other side.
Combos would be like putting irks with dribbles and then going to a cross and just keep going rapid footwork, you know what I'm saying? Just straight combos after another. No stopping, you know what I mean? Like, no pausing. It doesn't look like you thinking, you just going straight through them. Boom, 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 you know what I'm saying? But it's all neat though. The main element, you know what I'm saying, besides the feet, is your arms and your upper body. Like, a lot of people can't move their upper body when they dance, or they hold it a certain way, or or do. Do all other type of shit that should be incorporated with. Like, that's what a lot of people go wrong at. They don't think about that type of shit. They don't just look like no bullshit.
Walking the ghost is like you pretty much letting your hand control your every movement. So you like walking a dog. Like when you walking your dog, it's pretty much your dog is leading you and you just holding your hand. So you walking the dog. It's like a glide, skate, or whatever you want it to be. You just walking the dog. Nah, I'm more like simple. I'm really simple because I don't like to be doing all that extra stuff. That's not really me. I've been to a lot of dance groups as far as crew go. I always want to wolf back.
You know, everybody in Red Legends out of one of them, you know, either got Taliban or they was talking about Wolfpack. Somebody was talking about somebody under the umbra.
Where's Wolfpack from?
Well, it started from Ant.
I come from this umbrella, this guy named Ant Brown.
He like legendary. He, man, what started all this, like this form of dancing we doing now.
Everybody keeps saying, oh, Ant did, Ant started this, Ant did.
He taught people a style and basically everybody really put they kick to it and changed it up, you know. And that's how everybody made their name.
I can't say I didn't have my foot in it, but you know, a lot of people had their foot in it. It just wasn't me.
He the one really taught some of us who was in Wolfpack or Red Legends. He really taught all of us pretty much his style of and his other guys' style of dancing. Started from them.
I started footworking, I can't say. I think I was probably every bit of 12 years old. What got me into it were, it was a group called House-o-matics. It was a group called U5U in Chicago.
I was in House-o-matics first, and then I went to K59, U5U.
Yeah, we was they little bros. We had to get stroked in, you know, how fraternity do. You end up finding out, you know, new and better things. Like, okay, well, these guys doing a whole lot of different things. They doing routines as far as group-wise, stuff like that. And then at that point, I was skating. I know how to skate, you know, so my thing was with the dancing, I acquired skating into whatever they taught. And then that's how the footwork started to come along with me.
And how long to you sort of develop your own stuff?
It took me a pretty long time because I don't really like to like dance like everybody else. I try to choose my own way of style and dancing, and I just really created my own probably about a year or two ago.
It took me like about a year to get to that style of dancing, and then once I got that, it was just like I was making my own shit with it.
My own style of it didn't take long. I went from the back of the line U5U to the front of the line less than 3 days. I used to go home and practice. I also cut hair, I'm a barber. But I used to go home, cut hair, sit there, sit and listen to my guys. They'd bring like tracks or whatever to me, and I just sit there and cut hair until eventually I started like doing stuff at my own rate. Before you know it, I would take things, go to clubs, take things, and make it my own.
Yeah, that was Ant's main thing. Like, he started coming out with the combos and the basics and the, you know what I'm saying?
No, I was a rebel. I was always a person that wanted to do stuff the way he wanted to do it, and that was it. You know, never wanted to follow anybody. So that was my thing.
Before that, it was mainly whipping and popping and jumping around crazy. It wasn't all that neat. Like the style of dancing you see now, that's the style of dancing people who taught me brought to the game.
It's Tim and Barry. I came in high king. Just jam taking over. Don't watch that TV.
Pretty much what he recorded, we're going to chop up what he recorded into the MPC and chop up the samples real quick. And from there, we're going to make the track.
It's Tim and Barry. I came in high king. Just jam taking over. Don't watch that TV.
I like doing clever shit, like sampling movie clips, funny stuff, you know, out of the ordinary, but like, you know, we get it.
Tell that gay monkey to leave my shit alone.
We get it, it's inside joke. we making tracks off of us. Period.
Man's about the same. Mm-hmm. Ain't really, you know, I listen to them. We feed off each other. Hey.
But you got your own style though. You can't describe it.
I can't. I don't know what to say about my style. I let the people describe it.
Like Mania hook up a R&B sample for make a hard ass beat with.
Basically, it all starts from sampling. Be it a vocal sample or a melody or record, or, you know what I'm saying? So that's pretty much what it is.
I love sampling. I just love the feel of just taking another sound and manipulating it into something totally different.
She inboxed me her number, boy, that pussy gonna get took.
Yo, bitch, I got a traitor. I skate in the later. Yo, bitch, I got a traitor. I skate in the later.
She lurking on the book.
This nigga tweaking.
She lurking on, she's a scat.
Hey, say something on the mic.
Yo. What up, though? She inboxed me that number, boy, that pussy gonna get took.
She inboxed her number because of...
No, I said it right. She inboxed me that number, boy, that pussy gonna get took.
Nah, don't say your pussy.
I'm gonna say that.
I'm gonna say pussy.
She inboxed me her number, boy, that... I said, boy.
Hey, be quiet. You recording, folks.
I was recording. What was that?
Be quiet, man.
What you looking for, cuz?
This is the second time this shit happened.
We tripping, man.
Oh, hell. Shh. We're recording now. Shit.
I'm gonna find this. It's here.
Don't y'all turn that shit on? All right. Clear my throat. She lurking on the book. She lurking on the book. She inboxed me a number, boy, that pussy gonna get took. She lurking on the book. She lurking on the book. She inboxed me her number, boy, that pussy gonna get took. One take. Jay-Z status.
Oh, yeah.
You're
gonna
say Facebook.
Facebook.
Yo, bitch, I treat her, I skeet in the leader. Yo, bitch, I meet her, I skeet in the leader. Yo, bitch, I meet her, I skeet in the leader.
I'ma say that shit too, so we can double it up. Yo, bitch, I meet her, the leader.
I treat her, I skeeter, and the leader.
Like that status.
How the fuck? I can't stop talking. Who just told me shut up? I hear everything.
In the earphones? Hell yeah.
And the bitch.
Yo, bitch, I treat it, I skeet it, and delete it. Alright? Alright.
Yo, bitch, I treat it, I skeet it, and delete it.
Alright? Alright. Yo, bitch, I treat her. I see the end of leader.
Hold on.
Yo, bitch.
Huh?
Say that like more, right?
Oh, you don't want me, because I'm going to get loud. Yo, bitch, I treat her. I skeet her and delete her.
Yep.
Right? That was the one right there. That was the right one, wasn't it? The last one? Teklife.
Now, back to the weed issue.
Trying to tell you.
Well, see, like, you know,
you record shit in Logic and then chop it up in Ableton?
Well, with vocals, I just run them straight through Logic. As far as like our original vocals, it feels like an acapella or something, and I run it through Ableton.
So you're gonna chop this up in Logic now?
Well, not necessarily. I'm just gonna get the right samples that we need, the right good takes, and then put them right in here.
Oh, straight in.
Yeah.
She inboxed me a number, boy, that pussy gon' get took. She inboxed me a number, boy, that pussy gon' she inboxed me a number, boy, she inboxed me a number, boy, that pussy gon' get took.
Jay-Z song come on the radio or Kanye song, and I can't figure the sample out, and I don't feel like going on who sampled, I call my mom. Mom, listen to this. Tell me what this is. She'll tell me what the sample is. Her and Traxman are the two people that I go to if I don't know a sample.
Traxman is definitely the man to go to. Traxman and X-Ray, like, all the ghetto DJs, they older than us, so they done seasoned they ears to all kind of music.
What we finna have, I don't know, probably been about between you, Rashad, and Manny, there's probably been, I don't know, what, 30 tracks made? With a bean popping bitch that love to suck dick. She don't
leave the house, all she do is suck dick. Yeah, probably.
Maybe something like that in the week that we've been in.
Yeah.
How many tracks do you sort of personally churn out a month? Roughly.
It all depends. On a good month, when everything cool, bills paid, man, it's tracks every day. So, that's, man, probably 2 tracks a day, something like that. Then probably might have a day off. So, man, in a good week, I'm going to say about 15 tracks a week.
Right now, at this point in time, I'm actually DJing more than producing right now. As making a track with you guys, like the first time I made a track in almost 2-3 weeks. So it's because I'd be tired to go out and DJ, be out to 5-6 in the morning, and then sleep all day. So it's like, it's kind of, I would love it to be 50-50, but it's not enough hours.
Most of the stuff we do, though, don't get put out. We attest it at the parties and stuff like that. And that's what's going to see what's going to make the cut on the album. Or we'll put it on SoundCloud and see how people respond to it.
Really, we just ride around listening to our own music anyway. Just to listen to it, you know? So then to get people to like it, that's an extra plus. We either going to like it or not anyway. You know what I'm saying?
Okay, somebody else going to like it.
Somebody going to like it.
My feelings can't explain. everybody's favorite. If it ain't their favorite, they need to shoot themselves MPC.
Shit, I think you can use any analog drum machine. If you're good with it, if you're familiar with it, and you have good samples.
My very first sampler was a JS-30 by Roland. And I also saved enough money to buy an R-70 by Roland.
The R-70 right here, this machine was the first drum machine I ever used in my whole career. DJ Greedy used it, Dion, Milton, Sluggo, DJ PJ, Monty, Cosmo D. This is like the Southside drum machine right here.
When I got my first MPC, I got a 2000, but I upgraded maybe like 2 years, whenever the 2500 came out, maybe 2 years ago, 3 years ago, I upgraded and got me one of them jams.
This one is an MPC 2000. This is my first MPC I ever had right here. And I'm actually putting it back together. Need some more parts for it to put it back together. And I'm gonna give it to my son. My son makes tracks too, so it's going to him.
Any one of them, a 2000 to a 2000 XL.
And this right here is an MPC 2000 XL. This one is actually, is like a collector's piece because this is actually Spinn's old MPC. And this one right here, never leave my hands.
So a 3000.
Then this one right here is the granddaddy. This is the MPC 3000, Dr. Dre. Monty and PJ were the first people in the projects to have this drum machine. They made a lot of heat on this drum machine. Lil Lewis, you name it, Dr. Dre, Swizz Beatz, everybody has one of these.
So a 4000.
Right here is my baby. It's the brains of the whole outfit right here. The MPC 4000, the best MPC you could ever have. It does weigh, it does everything.
It's a 2500, the 1000, any MPC, like, just period. I gotta have that feel.
You get a car to holler us.
Yeah, you know what I'm saying? Sponsor a nigga. Shit. I'll wear your t-shirts.
Like, you could get the pad separate, but having that real MPC sequence, it's basically the sequencing that's in the machine. It's like the best ever.
It's not a set of parameters you click with the mouse. It's sort of similar, but the outputs are analog. It puts out electricity, and that goes through a mixing board, and bam, just get the hot. It's, the compressions are so good.
And like the timing, that MPC has got like this perfect timing when it comes to making music.
I think it kills software any day. This is why, because it's an instrument.
Like, I try to do it on computers, stuff like that. It's just not the same.
I just started recently using a machine like this year. I've been on Fruity Loops for some years.
I started DJing first. And I have to say, about maybe a year and a half after I started DJing, I started producing because due to the fact, like I was telling you earlier about WKKC, I was around a lot of cats that was producing. Like Paul Johnson, for example, he used to come onto the radio station with Gant and us, and he'll mix, and I'd be like, damn, that shit tight. Can I get this from gramophones? Like, no, I made that. I'm like, damn, you made it? So shit, I got interested into producing my own shit as well, and guys like him and Eric Martin pretty much kind of told us the do's and the don'ts and what you need to start off with and how to get it and just go for what you know.
Another thing, I feel if you don't feel the track like in your soul, because it's a soulful thing for me, and then I guess I can speak for a lot of guys with that. It's like you can't dance, you can't get to your peak. You know, you can try, but nah, it ain't gonna happen.
What's the problem with footworking? Creativity has died fast.
The difference back then, the music was slower. Like, we got taught out off of all slow tracks. Like, just perform the craft. You know, perfect it, master it.
Like, they developing their own craft now, but that's something we can't do because of the tracks are too fast or whatever.
It's a lot of motherfuckers watching other motherfuckers taking their moves, not doing them right. Everybody claim they created this, they made up this, but they can't even dance right.
You can't call somebody that's breakdancing really a footworker. You can't call nobody that's backup dancing a footworker. That don't mix with footwork.
You got people dancing like ballerinas and like they on the swim team out here. You know what I mean? Like, that's not the essence of footwork.
What the fuck are you doing, dude? The fuck? Can somebody please practice with that nigga, man? Please practice with that nigga, man.
I don't know. It look like river dancing to me. I can honestly say it look like river dancing to me. But, you know what I'm saying? The way we dance, it didn't look like that.
We was taught if you didn't know basics, you didn't know what you was doing.
It's either you're gonna footwork or you're not. You can't get on the basketball court and grab the ball with two hands and dribble. That's just not the rules.
A lot of these new guys, they don't do basics. I don't know what the hell they doing.
You gotta follow the rules and you're not footworking.
All you can see is a lot of mess.
When you footworking to me, it's telling the story.
Word.
The way you slide, the way you glide across the floor, the way you going to the beat, it tells the story. If you even go back to when dancing first started, the Africans, they dancing to a steady beat. Steady flow and steady pace. You just dance. You juking. I mean, you ain't making no sense. You just trying to say, you just humping around on the floor.
It's okay to dance, but dancing ain't footwork. You could do any type of dance.
I don't want people to look like, oh, that's Chicago footwork when it's not. That's like going to buy a pair of Jordans. You really own a pair of sights. That ain't right.
Word.
But when you stray away from the deepness, the basics and knowing how to call your moves out and combo, like, you straying away from the essence.
Like, if you ask, what was that whole move you did, we can repeat it, you know what I'm saying? But now you ask these guys to repeat it, I don't know what I did, I think I did this.
That's another thing, man. A lot of people who don't know shit about it is running a lot of shit in the game.
It's like, I felt like they could learn the craft first before they push it so hard.
Man, you gotta know your history. Like, a lot of people don't go do it, though, man. I don't know what's wrong with them. Like, I guess, man, YouTube told them they could do what they want to do. You could be who you want to be on the internet. I can call myself right now. I can say I made up footwork. If you guys don't come from this culture, you would think I made up footwork. You know what I'm saying? This was not just for, oh, man, I'm finna go to Hollywood. And this shit is not Hollywood, man. This shit is Chicago. That's what I'm trying to tell motherfuckers, man.
It's where it starts home. I did plenty of shows earlier and came back in, I'm still battling. That's how people want to see you. That's how you going to act when you come back here, where it started from.
Yeah, get your respect at the crib first. Like, that's cool, but like, it's like me going around a bunch of people who don't know nothing about footworking. Of course I can say I'm the best. I'm the king, because they don't know shit about this. You know what I'm saying? I'm the first one that showed it to them. So they're going to be like, oh, yeah, that's good. But when you come back here and you see the rest, you'll know the truth.
So if you feel like you're not battling hell, then what's the point of doing it?
This is where it came from. And if you can't be nothing here, you ain't on nothing nowhere else.
I think the exposure is good. It's way better than what we had.
And it's good for the world to see it, but it's good for the world to actually hear from people who really been doing it before it kind of went commercial.
It's progressing, but the downside of it, they're not really... Well, not the people I named, but some of the other people, like the Footwork Kings and King Charles and all of them, they're not really showing it in its true essence.
Charles, you're fucking the game up. You are fucking the game up, okay? Dancing in tights and to techno music is not what our culture is about.
Don't get me wrong. Yeah, Charles them footwork, but they juke footwork. Whenever you dance and you don't dance to a steady beat, steady pace, and a steady flow, you juke footwork. You not doing shit that makes no fucking sense.
How they dance with Madonna, you know what I'm saying, and did they whole little, what is that, dance crew thing.
So you think you're going to go in there and win, but you can't show your true form. You can't get off because you dancing to pop music, fam.
And I look at it like this, like that's just like if I was still footworking and say I was King Charles. I do whatever I gotta do and to get to that point. Then I get to that point, I'm gonna say, okay, I'm finna call a spin. gonna call Spinn, or I'm gonna put on Rashad, or I'm gonna call Manny, or I'm gonna bring somebody on, introduce them to these artists, and try to do a juke remix for their song so I can footwork to that song. That's what I would be on. Instead of, I'm gone here, I'm gonna footwork off of Madonna. I don't agree with that.
Just wanna, you know, capitalize off the shit.
We was doing this shit for the love. It wasn't for no money back then. Wasn't no money in it. You know what I'm saying? Wasn't no exposure in it. It was for the love.
Make your money, but at the end of the day, you know, come home.
You know, it gave Chicago exposure, you know, which is great. But at the same time, don't get cocky by that, because you still got other people out here that's real cold.
On the way to BG's.
That bitch still rocking them pebbles. 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 That bitch still rocking. That bitch still rocking. That bitch still rocking. That bitch still rocking.
Some of the hottest footworkers from Chicago, different areas, north, south, west, east. They meet up at this place called Battlegrounds, and we take it to the streets, and it's just straight raw, like straight battling what you finna see and get in tune with.
We got the west side, south side. We got all sides in this bitch. It's a Chicago thing, goddammit. I want to see niggas go hard, go ham. This real shit, though. They taping this shit. Niggas from London don't come over here and tape niggas from Chicago all the time. I swear to God. Hey, get it cracking in this bitch. Like a nigga off a yacht.
Get everybody back up behind that jump.
Battlegrounds is like one of the first ones that came back and brought it back.
Eat that hush it out the circle. Eat that hush it out the circle. Eat that hush it out the circle. Eat that hush it out the circle.
Like back when we was footworking, we didn't even have a spot. We just go to a footwork all night. We didn't have to go to a regular party and wait for one of our DJs to get up there and throw on the tracks. Yeah, but now you just go to Battlegrounds all night, track out. But yeah, that's where everybody go now. Yeah, it's been going for a long time. Without BGs, we ain't gonna have nothing else out. I go there for, like, you know, to warm up on the weekend. But that's where all the other niggas go there, you know. They let their stress go and, you know, let go. Let the head out.
That bitch ratchet. 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 That
bitch ratchet. It's always competitive. You know, it's friendly competition, but it's definitely a challenge. It's always a battle. Unless you don't feel like you able to compete, then you just there. But it's always competitive. You step in a circle with somebody to come at you. You gotta hold your own.
It makes me feel like no one's in the room when I hear music. No one is here. They talk about battling. What battle? I'm battling myself. I am my opponent.
You remember your first time in the circle?
First time in the circle?
It's that old
school. No, I don't.
What's the circle? The circle is like if you had a rap battle there, like the cypher, everybody group around, you know what I'm saying, open a big circle, one side against another side, you know what I'm saying, probably be us, the cold niggas on one side, and then the weak niggas on one side, you know what I'm saying, but the circle, you know. The circle's where it all goes down at.
Hey, yo, open that circle up, y'all. Open that shit up.
You step in the circle, you're liable to get painted red.
Uh-oh.
Actually, the first circle I was in, I lost to a female because she did a split on me once. Yeah, I vowed never again, never let a female beat me, yeah.
Man. I feel like you running the crowd right now, especially when they're like, ooh, ooh, you know what I'm saying? It's like you rocking the crowd, and then I feel like you on stage rocking the audience like a rapper or something. That's how you hype. You even had a weakness hype. Just to be in front of a crowd, they jump out there and show their ass. When you really got the crowd though, like, you know what I'm saying? That's the feeling.
You make the people respect you on the dance floor. And that got you respect in the streets, got you respect everywhere.
And right here, this is where the battles used to go down. Now, actually, right there at the tennis courts.
because people be out here playing basketball, but nobody play tennis in the hood. So ain't no Venus and Serena over here. So they took over the courts over there. You just got guys that just like to gather up and just be around this. I don't know what to call them. I don't want to call them groupies. They might try to jump me or something.
And this shit, like, man, I'm like, man, we've been to numerous parties, man. Like, this shit, the shit used to be parties. You know, it got us a lot of girls, you know.
Getting into all kind of clubs.
We was like many celebrities in Chicago over this shit, you know.
And I wasn't even selling dope.
Right, man.
Right. It just got to the point to where it was, I don't know, it just exploded, man.
You was like a mini celebrity over this, man. It was crazy. Like, man, you got honor, you know.
It was just a fun time, I don't know.
I swear to you right now, we could just pull up right here. We pull out with a van full of people and they just get out footwork, and I swear ain't nobody gonna touch them or nothing like that. You're gonna get a whole crowd. Mark my word, a whole crowd of people just gonna crowd around. No matter where you at, as long as it's busy, people gonna stop and pay attention. Everybody grew up on footwork and such, so like, that's the hard part about really doing what we do in Chicago, because we not looked at as like major artists get looked at. Like, people could actually see us. They see us at the liquor store. They see us driving around. They see us at the clubs and stuff like that. We actually stay attainable for the people, because we are. We're not nobody different. But at the same time, to get looked at, I think to get looked at on a different level, we got to kind of like disappear and come back with like security and shit. A lot of people, they don't like the fact that the music and the dancing get attention elsewhere other than Chicago. Selfish. Everybody just want to keep the craft to themselves.
I just said thank you for somebody opening the door and believing in what we could do, and now we here. And now we owe it to the world. Because why have a talent and not share it with the world? Like I tell people, that's what I mean, dying empty. Give it all back to the world, because you got it from the world. Give it back to the next generation and those to come.
It is better as far as like the exposure that these guys have, because they pushing the craft. I mean, they really pushing it.
I believe, just like a long time ago when it reached overseas with the ghetto house and the house music, and this was a thing that should have been done, you know, reached across a long time ago.
I just don't agree. Half the time with like these young guys, but at the same time they doing something great. You know, it's just not what we used to do, but it extends from it.
We got like generational music. Like, I know little babies that grew up. I was a little baby, and other little babies, we grew up for this, to it. And like, man, it's an amazing thing just to see it like 20 years later, like, flourishing and being something people talking about now, and hopefully it could be one of these things that could fit along in mainstream culture somehow, some way.
I'm gonna do what I want to do, and what I want to do is footwork. I don't care if it makes me money. That's not what it's about. It's about me expressing myself, and if I express myself, the whole world will see it and accept me. You know, I don't care if you accept me or not, but you understand where I'm coming from and feel the passion. It'll inspire you to do something just as great, because you see it. You see the opportunity, you see the determination, and you see the fight and the DJs and the dancers. And it can carry you to where, it can take you wherever you want to go if you put your mind to it and push yourself every day, recreate yourself every day, and just be better.
That's a cold ass white boy right there. I ain't gonna even lie. Back up. Let's go, T.Y. Bag up my whole side. T.S. Wolfpack. Tunnel all of y'all. Oh, shit. I got to quit. They shoot that. Zone. right side right there. Kenny, yo. Anybody behind Kenny, I need all the backup, Joe. We need some more room.
About that life.